Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior, forever. He sought me and he bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is to him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. I don't know about you, but I can sit here and sing that all night long. Lord, we serve a God who is mighty. He is mighty to save. He is mighty to deliver. He is mighty to redeem us from our sins. We serve a God, beloved, who loves us. We serve a God who has never been defeated. We serve a God who always, the Bible teaches, leads us in triumph. He leads us in victory. There is victory in Jesus. We've already sang tonight that we're not going to ever, never retreat. We're never, ever going to give in. You know, we just sing it about once a year at most of our congregations anymore. I'm not so sure we need to break out Lord's Army every week instead of just at vacation Bible school time. We understand that we are in a battle. We are, and the battle is raging, and the battle is for souls. People's eternity is at stake. The body of Christ, the disciples of Jesus, the church of the Lord Jesus Christ is the only hope that this world has. There's not another name. There's not another way under heaven given among men by which we must be saved. We serve a God who from the foundation of the world, before anything was ever created, came up with a way, determined that He would save us from our sin. The Bible describes Jesus as the Lamb of God slain from the foundation of the world. Before God created anything, He determined that this man that He would create, who He knew would fall, that He would prepare a way, and that although man would not be able to pay the price, man would not be able to win the battle on his own, man would not be able to earn his ticket to heaven, God determined that He would be victorious for them. Amen. That He would send forth His Son, that He would keep His will perfectly, that He would be qualified, that He would be worthy to open the scroll, to reveal the plan of God, and to accomplish it. It was our Lord who said, "It is finished." He said, "I came to do the work that my Father gave me to do. I came to accomplish." You know, when He was sitting there with the elders, He said, "I must be about my Father's business." I'm going to tell you something, beloved. He got busy and did that business and accomplished what God intended to accomplish through Him. The question is, what about us? What about us in this battle? What has God called us to do? You know, when I was a kid back in the 70s, they didn't send, you know, they taught us a lot about Lance leaders. We had all that kind of stuff. But they sent us a class. They called it Christian soldier class. Okay? They wanted to prepare us for battle. I hope the church hadn't lost sight of raising soldiers for this battle. This battle is not for the weak of heart, but it is for those who have enlisted in the army of God. And God has called us not to be entangled with the affairs of this world. We've already talked a little bit about this week. But what I want to concentrate on tonight is this. We serve a God who has already accomplished the victory in Jesus. Why in the world would anybody not sign up to be on a team and go to work on a team and run with confidence in a team that they know is going to win? I remember my first week of middle school. Anybody remember? That's a long time ago anymore. 52 years old. Some of you are a lot older than that. But I remember the first week of middle school. And I went to a pretty good sized school. And it come time, it was football time. It come time for the pep rally. Anybody ever been to a good pep rally? Yes. I never was a big time athlete or anything like Willie or some of these guys. But I remember going in there and we were in that gymnasium. Man, they were rocking that place. And I was sixth grade. And so we had to catch on a little bit because sixth and seventh and eighth had to compete to see who could be the loudest. And the cheer was this. And you know, I sit there and remember it from time to time. V-I-C-T-O-R-Y. That's the sixth grade battle cry. Did anybody ever do that one? Yes. And then the seventh grade would do it. Then the eighth grade would do it. We'd all do it together. And I wonder sometimes if the church has lost its battle cry. You know, sometimes we act like we're a bunch of whipped pups, you know, and don't carry ourselves and don't run with that confidence that God, that boldness that God has given to us in Jesus Christ. Never, ever retreat. Going back to God's plan, God showed that plan and revealed that plan throughout the pages of His holy word, didn't He? And He showed it to us through His people, the Israelites. Most of you be familiar with the fact that the Israelites wound up because of Joseph. That's a long story. We're going to try not to go through the whole thing tonight. But they wound up down there in Egypt, didn't they? They were there for a period of how many years? 400 years. And it was Joseph, and I mention him because he was one of the ones who said and reminded them and made them promise that when God came to deliver them, when God would keep His promise to Abraham, that He would give these people that land that He had promised to Abraham some 400 years ago. Joseph made a promise. He said, God's coming back to get us. And when He does, I want you to take my bones with you up out of here. Now, I don't know if anybody here lived 400 years. That's a long time. And I'm sure there were many of them who got pretty comfortable there in Egypt. I'm sure there were many who says, I don't think He's ever coming. I don't think it's ever going to happen. I think we're going to be here in Egypt forever. But there were some families there, there was a remnant there who kept that promise alive. Can you think about the beauty of that? Yeah, we're here now. But one day, we don't know when, one day God's going to come and He's going to deliver us. He's going to take us home to that land that was promised, that land that flows with milk and honey. Can you imagine maybe some Israelite people sitting up at night and dreaming about that taking place? Have you ever sat up at night dreaming about when God is going to send Jesus to come and get us? We'll begin our study tonight in Exodus, the 13th chapter. God raised up His servant Moses to lead the children of Israel out of Egypt. And when God called them to leave after the plagues, after the death of the firstborn, God says, get out of here. They take off, right? How do they know where to go? There's a pillar of what by day? A cloud by day, and a pillar of what by night? When the pillar of cloud or the pillar of fire moved, then the Israelites did what? So they didn't go where they wanted to go. They went where God showed them to go, didn't they? Then it came to pass. Verse 17, When Pharaoh had let the people go, that God did not lead them by the way of the land of the Philistines, although that was near. For God said, lest perhaps the people change their minds when they see war and return to Egypt. So God led the people around by the way of the wilderness of the Red Sea. And the children of Israel went up in orderly ranks out of the land of Egypt. They took the bones of Joseph with them. Most of us are familiar with the story. But I wanted to qualify before we went any further that they were in the place that they were in because God had led them to that place, right? Okay, everybody in agreement? And it was in that place that they found themselves in a bind because God had hardened Pharaoh's heart. Here comes the Egyptian army. All of a sudden, we've got ourselves in a situation to where we have a sea in front of us. We have mountains to the side of us, and we have an army of Egypt coming behind us. That don't look good, does it? But they were exactly where God wanted them to be. And God's going to say, I brought you here to show you something. Something they desperately needed to see. Something they desperately needed to understand. They needed to know who God was. They needed to know what God was capable of. And when God delivered them from the hand of the Egyptian, we all know the story, God parted the sea and delivered them on dry ground. Now they looked back and they saw all the Egyptians dead. Listen to what God tells them. They get all upset because they find themselves there. And Moses says to the people in verse 13 of chapter 14, "Do not be afraid. Do not be afraid. Stand still and see the salvation of the Lord, which He will accomplish for you today. For the Egyptians whom you see today, you shall see again no more forever. Say to the children of Israel," verse 15, "go forward." God delivered them that day. He gave them the victory. He showed them what He was able to do. Word of that, what had happened, went throughout the land, right? They finally get down there to Jericho and they go in there and talk to Rahab, remember that? And she said, "The people's hearts are melted because of what your God has done." Joshua and Caleb, the only two, and somebody, Willie, talked about that this week, how that entire generation of people that left Egypt perished in the wilderness because of their disbelief, because of the hardness of their heart. They got ready to go in. They sent spies into the land. 10 spies came back with what report? Can't do it. The people are giants. We look like grasshoppers in their eyes. It's a good land, okay, but it's not our land. We're not going to be able to take that, not in a million years. Right? You got Joshua and Caleb. They're like, what are you guys talking about? God's given us this land. It's a good land. This is what God promised to us. Let's go in and take it. I want to tell you something, beloved. What God is looking for today are some Joshua and Caleb that says, let's go take this land. Amen. Let God accomplish in us what He would. Why would we ever look back? Why would we ever retreat? Bob, you know if any coon hunters showed up?
I do.
He didn't. I had a good coon hunting story to go right here in this place. I had an old dog one time, and people back home don't let me talk about coon hunting anymore in lessons. But Bob brought it up. I had an old dog one time. I called him old Night Shift. And we were in a cast. We were in a competition, and I get to his tree. And the other dogs have already scored a coon. And I get to his tree, and I can't find his coon. And I look down there, and his old leg is swelling up. He's been snake bit real bad. I mean, his little leg big as my arm. And so they call time out, and they're going to move, and everybody expects that I'm going to go home. I'm beat. So we move on up the road, and here we go. We're going to get, and I'm getting him out, and they say, you going to hunt that dog? I said, yeah. As long as he's going to go, I'm going to hunt him. That probably was a foolish thing to do. But I knew I had a good dog, and I knew that I had a dog that had a lot of heart. And he come back, and he treated two coons. He won that cat. I always told him, I said, oh, Night Shift, he ain't got any quit in him. That's the kind of people God is looking for. Amen. People that don't have any quit in them. People that are going to say, hey, let's go. Let's go. God's given us this land. God has given us this people. God is with us. If God be for us, who can stand against us? Amen. Nobody. We are more than conquerors, the Bible teaches. Through him who loved us. There's nothing able to separate us from the love of God, beloved. Except us. If we walk away, if we quit, if we turn back, if we retreat. We said earlier that God's never lost a battle. You may remember after 40 years of wandering in the wilderness, and they finally get up there, and God parts the Jordan River. They cross over on dry ground. And God said, here's the battle plan. Jericho's this first city. Yeah, here's the battle plan. We're going to march around this thing. Anybody ever had a commander, anybody with any military experience in here ever heard a commander like that? Here's what we're going to do. We're going to go and we're going to surround this city and we're going to walk around it and we're going to go to shouting and breaking stuff. Yeah, let's go. No. Can you imagine there were some naysayers? You know, if I know our brother, you know, marching around that thing, there's somebody saying, what are we doing out here? This is ridiculous, marching around this thing. But they did it. They did it when they obeyed God. Guess what? Those walls came down. Every man went straight in. I'm going to tell you something, beloved. If we'll do what God has asked us to do, then God will fight the battle for us. Faith is what God is looking for. By faith, Hebrews chapter 11, those walls of Jericho fell. There's no wall. There's no army. There's no city. There's no government. There's no Satan. There's no kingdom that could ever stand against God. What a great victory. Then people got a little full of themselves. Oh, look at us. Man, this is really working. All right. And Achan went and took that stuff and buried it in that tent, right? And everybody's all excited. Somebody said, well, what's the next city? Well, Ai. And everybody's like, Ai's nothing. Go on, I just sent a few up there. Boy, feeling pretty tough about yourselves, right? They went up to Ai without God, and guess what? They got whipped, cost about 36 men their lives. Now the people are, oh, God brought us out here to die. Beloved, if you go to battle with God, you cannot lose. That's right. But if you go to battle without God, you cannot win. This is not about us. This is about Him. This is about His power. This is about the victory that God has accomplished through Jesus Christ for us. God said, I want you to go and fight. And I'm going to go with you. That's what he told Israel, right? I'll be the hornet. I'll send the hornet. I'll fight for you. I'll fight with you. When they understood that the power was from God, there was nobody who could stop them. God didn't need what God needed. What access to the power of God has always been the very same thing. Faith. Remember that bleeding woman, that woman that had issue of blood? Believed that she could, if she could get to it, if she could touch the hem of his garment, she could be healed. She does that very thing. Makes it to it. Touch that garment. Jesus said, "Who touched me?" So I was like, everybody's touching you. Somebody touched him in faith. Remember what Jesus, she immediately, the Bible says she was healed. Remember what Jesus told her? Woman, your faith has healed you. Made you whole. Guess what? It wasn't a faith healing on her part. It wasn't her. But when her faith accessed the power of God, beloved, there was immediate healing. God's power has always been accessed the same way through faith. God didn't need a big army. God needed some big faith. Remember Gideon? How many did he gather up? 10,000, 20,000, I don't even remember exactly. Thousands. God says too many. Whoever's scared, whoever got family issue, responsibility, send them home. Just down to 1,000. Man, I wish I remembered my numbers. I need to be a better Bible student, don't I? I'm going to talk about it. Still too many. Tell them to go down and get a drink. Whoever laughs like a dog, send them home. Get down to what, 300? I got that one right, didn't I?
Yes, sir.
God didn't even need 300, did he? Somebody brought up earlier the feeding of the 4,000, feeding of the 5,000. Jesus fed all these people. I always loved that story. His disciples are getting all upset. They're like, "Hey, this could turn into trouble, man. A lot of hungry people. Things could go south real quick. You need to get them out of here." Jesus said, "Go see what you got." they didn't have anything. That's the first thing we got to realize, blood. We ain't got it. A few loaves and fish, Jesus said, "Bring it on." I'm going to tell you something, beloved. There's some loaded fish sitting in right here, and Jesus said, "Bring it on. I'll feed the world with it." Remember Elisha? During the days of Elisha, there was a commander of the Syrian army. Syria and Israel was at war, you know, they were warring against each other. The Bible starts to tell the story about Naaman, this captain of the Syrian army. A valiant man, good man. He was a leper. There's a little old Israelite girl been taken captive. And she was serving Naaman's wife. She says, "I know somebody that could heal him. Now, if I'm that little old girl and they've got me captive and I'm taken away from my parents and I'm in a strange place and among strange people in a different land that are warring with my people, the people that kidnapped me, That's most of us, isn't it? Good riddance to him." I'm going to tell you something, beloved. That little girl knew who God was. And that little girl knew what God was capable of doing. And she wasn't afraid. And she felt some kind of responsibility to share it with him. Beloved, this world is sick and dying. How could we say good riddance to them? They're going to get what they deserve. We know God. We know God's heart. We know that God has called us to follow after Him, to have that same, the mind of Christ. You know what Paul says? "Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, yea, death on the cross." Beloved, if Jesus gave up all the riches and glory and honor of heaven, took on the form of a bondservant, came and humbled himself and gave his life, the least we could do was tell somebody about Him. You don't have to die. You don't have to be dominated by sin. Amen. Jesus, and this was supposed to be later in the lesson, but it's coming in right now, entered into death, bound Satan, destroyed him who had the power of death. And that what Hebrews 2 at 14 says, inasmuch as the children have partaken of flesh and blood, he himself likewise shared in the same, that through death he might destroy him who had the power of death, that is the devil, and release those who through fear of bondage were all their lifetime subject to bondage. Jesus came to release us from prison. He came to release all men from prison and to take them from death to life. And He's enlisted us in this army to work against Satan, who is trying to hold on to the people of the world. The good news is that all people can come out of that prison. If there are no doors on the prison and the warden has been tied up, why in the world would anybody still be sitting in the prison? That's where we come in. Hey, you people over there in the prison, you don't have to be in there. Come out. Come to life. Oh, this battle. You can go to several different places throughout the Bible and throughout the Bible and see God delivering His people over and over and over again. I love 2 Chronicles chapter 20. Chapter 19 and 20. Israel never had a good king. That's what's so sad about this whole thing. Judah had a few good, decent kings. Jehoshaphat was one of them. And 2 Chronicles 19 at verse number 3, it said that he had prepared his heart to seek God. And lo and behold, the beginning of verse chapter 20, verse 1, it happened that after this, that the people of Moab and the people of Ammon and others with them, besides the Ammonites, came to battle against Jehoshaphat. This great multitude, word came to it. Then some came and told Jehoshaphat, verse 2, there's a great multitude coming against you from beyond the sea, from Syria, and they are in Hazazon Tamar, which is En Gedi. And Jehoshaphat feared and set himself to seek the Lord. The first thing he did, he proclaimed a fast throughout all of Judah. Gathered them together to ask help from the Lord. From all the cities of Judah, they came to seek the Lord. Big battle raging. Big, huge multitude of an army coming. The first thing Jehoshaphat does is seek help from the Lord. In verse 12, he says, "Our God, O our God, will you not judge them?" I love this, these next words. "For we have no power against this great multitude that is coming against us." You ever been there? Seems like sometimes the enemy is big, doesn't it? Seems like they're pushing all of this agenda on us. It seems like they're making progress, leaps and bounds against us. And Jehoshaphat confesses to God that we have no power against this great multitude that is coming against us, nor do we know what to do. You ever been there? Don't know what to do. "But our eyes are upon you." Brother, that's exactly where we need to be right now. With our eyes on Him. All of Judah, I love this next part. All of Judah with their little ones, their wives, their children, family, they all stood before the Lord. Isn't that something? The message was sent. Listen, Judah, listen, inhabitants of Jerusalem, and listen, King Jehoshaphat. Thus says the Lord to you. Here it is again. Do not be afraid. What about, there's a big multitude out there. They're bigger than us. They're powerful. We don't know what to do. We're scared. We've got our family and our wives and our little ones here. And God says, don't be afraid because of this great multitude. For the battle is not yours, but God's. I'm going to tell you something, beloved. We need to understand that. We need to believe that. That's the truth of God, that the battle belongs to Him. Here's what we're going to do. Here it is again. You will not need to fight in this battle. Position yourselves, stand still, and see the salvation of the Lord who is with you. Do not be feared, be dismayed tomorrow. Go out against them. Here's what we're going to do. We're going to go out and we're going to sing. What? Are you kidding me? Yes, God delivered them into His hand. Jehoshaphat, verse 18. Bowed his head with his face to the ground, and all Judah and the inhabitants of Jerusalem bowed before the Lord, worshiping the Lord. Levites and children of the Kohathites, children of the Korahites, stood up to praise the Lord, God of Israel, with voices loud and high. They began to sing, verse 22, praise the Lord, and to praise. The Lord set ambushes against people of Ammon, Moab, and Mount Seir. Verse 24. Judah came to the place overlooking the wilderness. They looked toward the multitude, just like there at the Red Sea and the Egyptians, and there they were. The dead bodies fallen on the earth. Not one had escaped. What a beautiful, beautiful sight. We don't fight physical nations anymore, do we? But oh, beloved, that battle is still raging. It is a spiritual battle. Jude, verse 3, you know, he's saying, I wanted to write concerning our common salvation. I wanted to hear that lesson. I wanted to read that letter. Maybe one day we can asked about that. But he said, I was compelled to write to you, urging you to contend earnestly for the faith. That's the battle that God has called us into. Paul said he fought the good fight. And Paul wasn't out there fighting Ammon and Moab and some of these other places. But he was warring against Satan. He was warring against evil. He was going to any means to preach the gospel, the good news of Jesus Christ, so that people could be saved. And at the end of his life, guess what he said? He said, I fought the good fight. I finished the race. I kept the faith. Now, therefore, is laid up for me a crown of righteousness. Victory. And beloved, leading us in this victory is none other than Jesus Christ Himself. Sure, He's the Lamb of God slain for the sins of the world, but He's also the Lion of the tribe of Judah. He is the victorious and conquering warrior. Beloved, victory is ours in Jesus, who entered Satan's prison house of sin and death and defeated him. Listen to these words. Revelation 19, beginning at verse 11. And I saw heaven open, Behold, a white horse. And he who sat on him was called Faithful and True. And in righteousness he judges and makes war. His eyes were like a flame of fire, and on his head were many crowns. He had a name written that no one knew except himself. He was clothed with a robe that was dipped in blood, and his name was called none other than the Word of God. And the armies in heaven, clothed in fine linen, white and clean, followed him on white horses. And out of his mouth goes a sharp sword, that with it he should strike the nations. And he himself will rule them with a rod of iron. He himself, that is Jesus, treads the winepress of the fierceness and wrath of Almighty God. And he has on his name, he has on his robe, and on his thigh, a name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. It was our Lord who took the punishment. It was our Lord who shed his blood in our stead. He is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. He's the one who leads us in battle. And leads us in triumph. He took the wrath of God, the punishment of God. He defeated Satan. He bound the strong man to set the captives free. Beloved, God has promised us that in Jesus Christ, our Lord, We too can be victorious over death. That's what I want. That's what I want for my family. That's what I want for my friends. And if we're followers of Christ, we have the mind of Christ, that's what we want for all men. Everyone can have the victory, but only in Jesus. If people are going to have victory, they got to hear about Jesus. They got to hear about what Jesus has done. They got to understand who Jesus is, that he came from God, that he kept the will of God perfectly. That's the reason death had nothing in him. Death could not hold him. Acts chapter 2 and verse 24, it was impossible that death should hold him. Beloved, the reason that is because he never transgressed God's will, not once. He was worthy. And he took our sin in his body on the tree. And through his blood, we can be cleansed of our sin. The Bible teaches that we've got to believe that Jesus is who he claimed to be, the very Son of God. And wouldn't we confess that before men? Wouldn't we be proud and honored to confess the sweet name of Jesus? And what a privilege it is. It's makes sense. You know, a lot of people look at it, we got to repent. No, you get to repent. That's a joy. It ought to be a great joy. I don't have to live this way anymore. I don't have to be in bondage to sin. I don't have to talk the way that I used to talk. I don't have to go to the places I used to go. I'm free from that. It's a mindset. It's a direction, a change of direction. And it's one that we should want. If I heard that story about Jesus, I'd want to find a way into him as fast as I could get there. I'd want to lay a hold of him as fast as I could get there. And the Bible says what man is called to do is conform to the very death, burial, and the resurrection of Jesus. That is, we would die to self. When we recognize just what we've done, when we recognize that we've sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, when we recognize that we are lost and we're separated from God by that sin, wouldn't we then want to die to that self, that old person, that old man, and be buried, the Bible says, in baptism into his death and raised by the power of God to a new life? Hey world, hey people that are lost in sin, you can have a new life in Christ Jesus. You can be raised by the power of God. Romans chapter 6, he raised in the likeness of his resurrection. Begs the question, what is the likeness of the resurrection of Jesus? Well, let's see. Jesus is the first fruits of those who are raised from the dead. There have been other people raised from the dead, right? What happened to all of them? They died. Jesus is the first fruits of those who are raised from the dead to die no more. And beloved, whenever you enter that grave, and when God raises you to a new life, it is a life that will never end. It is eternal life. Oh yeah, this old body, this old tent's going to wear out, and they're going to throw dirt on it one day. But my soul will never be separated. I don't have to die. I can be resurrected to eternal life. Well, there's some people that believe, well, that's all you got to do. Once you get baptized, then you just sit around, wait, and maybe sit on a church pew until Jesus comes or you die. That ain't what the Bible teaches. Then we go try to rescue as many people as we can. Because we realize they are dead just like we were. There's hope for our world. There's hope for our country. There's hope for this state. There's hope, beloved. It's found in Jesus. And it's found in the body of Jesus. So let's go into all the world and preach Jesus and the victory that can be had in Him. If you're subject to the invitation of Christ tonight, I want you to know one thing, that you're surrounded by people that love you and that God can deliver you and will deliver you if you'll put your faith and your trust in Him. And come in obedience to His Word, His good and perfect Word and will. You're surrounded by people that love you more than anything. And I know a lot of these guys. I know a lot of these people who would do anything in their power to help you come to Jesus, to help you understand the gospel, to help you to obey the gospel, and to then remain faithful unto Him all the days of your life. Thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Let's stand together and sing. If you need to come, come.